In this After Effects tutorial, I'll show you how to create shapes with a frosted glass texture and how to make a seamless loop out of it. Hi guys, my name is Manuel. The effect we're going to create, and you might have heard that before, is also called glassmorphism. So without any further ado, let's jump right in. We create a glass shape first, so let's create a comp for that and name it shape 1. Or so. Square, like 1080 by 1080 pixels, 5 seconds long. Then we choose the rounded rectangle tool and double click on it to add a shape. Let's name the layer blur. We open the rectangle path property and set the size to something like 550 by 400 pixels. The roundness to around 50. White fill, no stroke. The fill color doesn't really matter though. We duplicate the layer, name it glass. Let's open this path property as well and link the rectangle path size and the roundness from the top shape to the bottom shape using the property pick whip. Let's close this again and hide the upper layer for now. And use the effects and presets window to add Gaussian blur to the layer. Blurriness around 25 to 30. Then we turn it into an adjustment layer, so the effect applies to the layers below it. We need that for later. Then let's work on the glass layer. First of all, let's use a gradient as fill. Colors, from a bright red or rose to a very bright pink. Okay, let's adjust the direction. Awesome. Then we grab the ellipse tool, switch here to create a mask. And add a mask, covering almost the whole shape. Then we add a mask feather, and that's probably too much, of around 570 pixels or so, which makes it transparent. Then we add noise, around 10% no color noise. Finally, we add a layer style by right clicking on the layer, bevel and emboss, size 12. Soften 16. And let's change the angle to around 50 degrees maybe, so that the white highlight is somewhere along the top. And let's change the colors. Let's use yellow as a highlight color and pink as a shadow color. We duplicate the glass layer, name it glass edge, and disable the fill and add a stroke. I'll crank up the width for now to make it easier for you to see what's going on. We need to delete the mask and the layer style. Then we add trim paths. Set the end to around 20%. We adjust the offset value so that it rounds the upper right corner. Then we go into stroke, then taper, and set the start and end length to around 50%. Let's reduce the stroke width to 2 pixels. And let's change the color into a bright pink maybe. We duplicate the edge layer and change the stroke color to white. I quickly increase the width again for a better visibility. Then adjust the offset value to move it around the left corner. Shrinking the width again, of course. Awesome. Let's create a new comp, name it loop, 1920 by 1080 pixels this time, 5 seconds long. We add a new solid, name it background. And add a 4 color gradient. And then change the colors. Let's keep it very bright, like almost white. So let's make the first point white, then a very bright pink. For some contrast, a very bright cyan and a bright pink again. And let's add some jitter. Then let's add the shape we've created, duplicate it, and they're overlapping, but nothing happens. We need to activate collapse transformations for the blur effect to apply. Next, let's create some more shapes. We duplicate the shape 1 composition, then simply change the size of the rectangle path. which is very easy because we linked everything to the bottom shape layer. The red numbers indicate that the property is linked. And let's change the colors of the fill gradient in the glass layer. I stick to an overall red color scheme. I've created three different shapes and added them to the loop comp. And changed the scale of some of them. Now, let's create that loop. First of all, we open all position properties, right-click on them and separate the dimensions. We only want to animate the X positions. Second, we move all shapes out of the screen. I want to move the shapes from right to left, so I move them to the right. Then we set X position keyframes for all layers. Then we go to the end of the timeline, select all the shapes and move them to the left. We offset some of the keyframes to get varying speeds. Then we adjust the endpoints of the layers. Now, the shapes are all moving at the same time, which is clearly not what we want. So we move some of the comps to the right to offset the timing. The goal is to have moving shapes visible at all times throughout the loop. Next, we go to one frame after the last frame in the timeline, which is right here, and split the layer. Then we try to grab the second part and move it to the beginning of the timeline, which is frame 1. We repeat that with all the other layers that reach beyond. That looks much better already. Yeah, I would recommend to change the label colors for these split comps. That makes it much easier. If we move comps to the left, it's the same principle. We split the comps at the beginning and move the hidden part to the end of the comp. Alright, not too bad. And if I want to change the Y position, like for this shape for example, we select it and move it up or down in this case. The same with a split layer. Simply select both of them. That's when the label colors make it easy. And move the shape. This is my final result. You might want to check out the project file. On the left side, I've added some videos you might like. Subscribe to my channel on the right side and hit the bell, because you don't want to miss my next video. Thanks for watching this one. See you in the next one. Bye, guys!